shall we talk about? Nadia asked me to tell us something about heritage policies in the Netherlands, but I think it might also be of interest to go a bit further into detail on the so-called shared heritage program that the EU has. Especially since that is actually one the main reason for my visit to Indonesia this time, is to look after a redefinition of our shared heritage program and also a redefinition of our cooperation with Indonesia. And so maybe that also is something that I can explain how it works and maybe have some input from you as well. So this is a presentation I made earlier for another occasion, so I hope you allow me. But it covers, I think, the things on our institute that I could discuss with you and explain you, and you have an idea on who we are and what we do. So I'll tell quickly something about the organization, the protection that we do as a part of the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science, the World Heritage in the Netherlands, what our present challenges are, and then I come to the Shared Heritage Program and then switch to another presentation. Right. First of all, how are we organized? So, where I work is the Cultural Heritage Agency of the Netherlands, which is part of the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science. And this is the main office of the ministry in The Hague, close to the central station in The Hague. For the ones who have visited The Hague, they probably have visited the station, so may quite well have seen the building. Within the ministry, there is a Director General for Culture and Media, and within this Director General, there is the heritage sector. And the heritage sector actually covers three departments. One is a policy department, located in this same building in The Hague. The other is the Cultural Heritage Agency, and then we have one being the National Archives. And for the ones who not yet have met, Johan, my colleague from the National Archives, also present here. So he is from the National Archives and currently working also on within the same shared heritage program. So if we have a discussion, Johan may include as well. Right. So what you may notice, or what I maybe should explain, is that here, with this covers actually the all the tangible heritage. All the tangible heritage are covered by Dutch government. So the paper sources are covered by National Archives, and all the other tangibles are covered by the Cultural Heritage Agency of the Netherlands, being archaeological sites, being monuments and cultural landscapes, and being museum collections. The immaterial, the intangibles, are not covered by government. Yet there are two private institutes in the Netherlands who are dealing with the issue of the immaterial heritage. One is a more a research institute called the P.M. Mertens Institute, and the other is well, institute that's more looking after more implementation and getting the people involved in heritage issues. So, having said so, then we go deeper into the Cultural Heritage Agency. As I mentioned, so we cover actually four disciplines, being archaeology, also including maritime archaeology, monuments, cultural landscapes, which mainly are actually urban landscapes, but can also be natural landscapes, and then all museum collections. Where are we located? We are not located in The Hague, as you might have expected, but we are located in the center of the country, in a city called Amersfoort. And the reason for that is mainly the fact that we serve the whole country, and then it's handy to be in the center of the country. In a small country as Holland, that's very handy. So from Amersfoort you can almost reach every part of the country by car within 1 hour. It's up and down. And from Amersfoort, the farthest place you can go by car will be about 2.5 hours away. So small countries. So as you see, we are in a brand new building, which was built in the year 2009, which we anticipate on being it the heritage of the future. But what you should also keep in mind, and being architects here, you certainly will know and understand, building a building like this also is a statement. Hello, welcome. Yes, nice. So it is a statement also, of course, a building like this. It's brand new, and what it actually wants to show, what it wants to tell the world, is that heritage is not only something from the past, but heritage is something in the middle of each ever-changing society. So that is the statement that our department wants to make. Heritage is a part of the present, of a modern and evolving society. That is correct. So it is in the present, not only from the past, but it's also in the present. But of course, there is something you can argue. There were quite some arguments on this, telling why do you build a brand new building in a situation where actually we have too many empty office buildings, and why don't you set an example in adaptive green? Okay, this is quite an interesting issue. The organization. Well, let's not talk too much about this. Altogether, we have some 330 people working within the organization. And they are divided, actually, one could say, actually in two disciplines. One is actually the front office, dealing with all the property owners, governmental institutes and municipalities, so maybe advising them how to deal with all the heritage that should be managed. And there is a back office that is doing more research. And then the way we are organized is, well, it's a bit complicated, but so we work in programs, meaning that depending the issues that are topical, we can define a different program, so then we can take different people from different departments into one program. Rights. Protection. So, due to the Monuments Act, we have the ability, by the name of our minister, to list heritage. That is to say, the Monument Act distinguishes in three categories. One are monuments, the third are townscapes, and the second is townscapes, and the third is archaeology. And so for the sake of this meeting, I now mainly focus on the built heritage. So I don't speak too much on the archaeology, and also not too much on the museum collections, but mainly on the built heritage and how we deal with that. This is a bit of a complicated scheme, but I will quickly try to explain. We have the Monument Act and we have the Physical Planning Act. Actually, it wants to show how the Monument Act and the Physical Planning Act are interrelated to be able to be in on the ground, to act where necessary in order to give the heritage that is there, to give it a new future. Since what generally is the case, heritage what happens with heritage? Heritage is something from the past. And while the society moves on, heritage tends to leave behind. And now, actually, our job is to fill this gap, to somehow make sure that the heritage that stays behind is pulled into today's society by changing this heritage, or sometimes by molding the society. So that actually is our main task, filling the gap between the heritage that is leaving behind and the society that's moving on.
Right.
And so there are several means to do so, and one is in the Monument Act, and it helps us to give protection to monuments and protection to townscapes. Then you have to keep in mind that the Netherlands is a rather decentralized country, meaning that most of the decisions are made on the local, municipal levels. And that's also the case if it comes to heritage. Meaning that if it comes to listing, it is done on the state level, but where it is implementation, it is done on the municipal level. Meaning that once a monument is listed, the permits are issued by the municipality. The same goes true for protected townscapes. Only the legal result of listing the townscape is different from the legal result of protecting monuments. The result is actually that a land use plan has to be made by the municipality, and a land use plan is related to the Physical Planning Act. This is actually quite an interesting feature of the Dutch Monuments Act, meaning that actually here, where it comes to the protected townscapes, two goals are related, the one of the Physical Planning and the other of the Monuments Act. The goal of the Monument Act in the end is to keep historical features for future generations, and the goal of the Physical Planning Act in the end is to improve living conditions. So where the two meet, it is actually about improving living conditions by making use of the existing building stock. That's actually what it is about. Or put the other way around, keeping historical features as far as they can be used for current social needs. So that actually is where it comes together. And so in this way, we are able to guide, or actually to get involved in urban renewal plans and also in preservation. So that is a bit complicated, but that's how it works. I have to mention, actually, that currently we are in the big change of our Monument Act. The Monument Act is being reversed, and now we are working on a completely new Heritage Act, including also all the other kind of heritage, so also including the museum collections. Not only that, we are also in Holland very much working on a redefinition, or actually a new Physical Planning Act, which is called differently now, meaning that actually this will change from the Monument Act to the Physical Planning Act. But then it gets reversed, so the one responsible is the Ministry of Housing and Physical Planning, but the one that is advising or giving content still is the cultural heritage agency. Okay, I hope that's not too complicated. Right. So, what do we protect? We protect monuments. We have, on a state level, some 65,000 monuments listed, and they have several categories. Most of them are residential buildings. A lot of them are religious, but also agriculture, and next to that, mills, castles, things like that. Next to the listed buildings on a national level, there are also monuments listed on a local level, depending on the municipality. that altogether are, I guess, 40,000 monuments. So altogether, in Holland, there are some 100,000 buildings listed in one way or another, being about 1% of the total building stock. So we have, they can be residential dwellings. Okay, I will not go too deep into this. Okay, they all have, of course, their own issues, their own difficulties, their own challenges and possibilities. Farmhouses, like here, quite famous in the northern part of the Netherlands, the province of Groningen mainly, there, especially in the 19th century, huge barns were built, which today actually are of no use anymore. So it's quite difficult to find ways to keep this kind of heritage alive for the future. Windmills, of course, also quite a difficult category. They serve no actual goal anymore, so they mainly serve touristic goals, which makes it difficult to maintain. Castles and estates, religious, oh, that's quite an issue in Holland, quite different thing from Indonesia. In Holland we are at this moment currently very much in the process of, how you say, that's the right word, people don't go to church anymore.
Agnostic.
Well, even I think they may be artists. Well, actually, I'm not sure, but anyway, they don't go to church anymore. It does not. They need not.
Believe in the higher being, but not practicing.
That's logic. Also, but besides, quite some atheists as well. Anyway, it means that a lot of churches are standing quiet, and so what to do? And it's about, this time, I think there's about one church per week is coming out. So that's quite a huge problem. What to do with all these churches? How do you find how do you find the means to keep them vital for a future generation? Quite a challenge. Industrial heritage is also quite an issue at the moment, since living in a postmodern world, we change from industrial society to much more a service society. So also in the industries, a lot of buildings are getting idle this type of thing. And then, for example, this one, being the Fennel factory, it is a World Heritage Site, but quite difficult to find a way to keep it alive. And I think in the case of Fennel, they succeeded quite well in the new concept, especially I think in architectural intervention, which is quite interesting. So they intervened in the architecture in a way that it's possible to give it a new use, but does not affect the architecture, and actually you could say that it adds to the architecture. So in that respect, I think it is a very interesting example, especially if it comes to architectural interventions. So if you are ever in Holland, please visit. And of course, make your own opinion. Okay, so these were the monuments. Then we have some townscapes. Here it says 425, I think it is more. It must be some 440 by now listed in the whole of Netherlands. They can be townscapes, like the city of Groningen in the northern part of the country. And here you see the red line covering the area that is protected as a protected townscape. And this is seen from above. They can be agricultural villages, like here the village of Twisk in the province of North Holland. Very interesting 19th century development. I will skip that, but the history is very interesting. And this is how it looks from street level. They can also be landscapes, natural landscapes, as here on the border between the province of Limburg and the province of Noord-Brabant, in what is called the Beel. And it was developed in the 19th century as you may see, for peat extraction. That is why it is parceled in this way. After the peat was extracted, it was transformed to an agricultural landscape. And all these different layers give a very special atmosphere. And then the whole idea is, how are you able to keep these features in a future that is changing? So that is actually what this protected townscape is used for, although the term in this respect is a bit strange, it's more protected natural landscape. So what it actually is about, what kind of functions can you find for this landscape that fit within this sort of features? Can you find new features, or can you find new functions that provide a base of existence to this sort of features that you think to be of interest? And then it is very much the agricultural functions very much offer opportunities to do so. So for that reason, once the landscape is misted, the municipality draws plans to somehow support and create the conditions for the agriculture to develop in this area so that it can sustain these sort of features. Incentives. The Dutch Monument Act also knows some incentives. Once the heritage has been listed. And then if it costs, we should distinguish between monuments and townscapes. In the case of monuments, there is a distinction between maintenance and restoration. In the case of maintenance, there is a possibility of tax deduction. If I live as a person in a dwelling that has been listed, I can somehow, to a certain extent, deduct the maintenance cost I make for my house from my tax. Yeah? If it comes to restoration, so if my house has to be completely restored, then there is a difference between dwellings and bigger buildings. If it is about bigger buildings, then there are subsidies, and they are divided by our agency. If it comes to dwellings, to residential buildings, then we have no subsidies, but we have low renting loans. So you can apply for a loan, which is on a low rent, and for that reason, the loan. Okay? If it comes to the incentives for townscapes, they are not in money, but they are actually in legal security. Once a townscape is listed by national government, local government has to provide a land use plan that creates conditions for a future perspective. And that's this land use plan provides a legal security for the people that live here or the people that invest here. So it's not a matter that it offers me money, but it offers me a future perspective. And by doing so, what we hope and what works out, we tempt people to invest in their own property. If I know that the surrounding, my neighborhood, will be well kept for the next 10 years, I am usually tempted to, or I tend to be willing to invest in my own property. Usually more than when I do not know if maybe tomorrow, in the past next week, a high-rise building might be erected. If that's the case, I will be a bit reluctant in investing in my real estate, since it might lose its value. But if I know that the area around me will be looked after carefully, I am willing to invest in my property so that it raises value. Okay. Anyway, that is a theory, and it also works out. Right. Then we have some World Heritage listed. I should watch time, I think. We have 10 sites listed now on the World Heritage List. The first one ever listed in the Netherlands was the case of Schokland, actually an archaeological site. Then, of course, yeah, we have the windmills. How could we forget? Next, there is, of course, the land reclamation, which is quite a feature from the Netherlands. This is the pole called the Beemster. We have the Amsterdam Defence Line, a huge military system dating from the 19th century around Amsterdam. Actually, a huge landscape, a military landscape, quite interesting. We have the largest steam, largest pumping. A water pump working on steam power. There is, as an example of the modern movement, the Rietveld Scheurhuis. We have the 17th century canals of Amsterdam. And also in Curaçao, one of the remains of our colonial past. Curaçao is in the Kingdom of the Netherlands, but not in the Netherlands. Quite complicated. But the Kingdom of the Netherlands has also a few countries in the Antilles. One of them is Curaçao, and on Curaçao there is Willemstad, and that has also been. Then, the last that has been listed is the vanilla factory. Okay. And then, oh yeah, there is a tentative list of these sites. So they are supposed to be nominated during the coming, let's say, 10 or 15 years. So that's quite a huge. What are our present key challenges? Three main challenges we're facing now. One is post-war heritage, civic participation, and updating of a heritage policy. This last one actually is already more or less done. Post-war heritage. After the war, a huge building program has been done in the Netherlands, mainly from a modernist perspective. Huge areas, mainly residential areas, had been constructed in that time in the suburbs of the big cities. That is about 50 years ago now. So now they are at a point where we should decide, should we restore them or should we demolish? Or what should we do with them? They are now at the level that something has to be done. So that's one of the main challenges. Civic participation is also one of the issues where we actually hope to learn also from other countries in Asia and also from Indonesia. I think Indonesia is more advanced on this issue than we are. Updating the present challenges, mainly two issues. Spatial planning, as I before explained, the spatial planning offers conditions for heritage to sustain. So we are looking for more possibilities to work with the physical spatial planning. Fewer rules, that is one of the main items that today mainly all the businessmen are complaining about. And as I learned these days, the same is true in Indonesia. So we have to look after that. And what we are also very much looking after is adaptive reuse, so trying to find new uses for old buildings. As for example, this old factory building in the city of Utrecht, and maybe Nadia recognizes you in some. Do you recognize this?
It's
close to the office. It is, yeah. Okay. So I myself actually live quite close by now. This was a process of I think 15 years it took to get it all organized, old factory building. Now it has been reused for all kinds of facilities for the men. Conservation is organized.
This one?
This one. Rodley Hout is organized in the Netherlands and how we are involved as a cultural heritage agency. At the start, I told you that the way we work usually is based on programs. One of these programs is related to shared heritage, and that's also a program where we reach out to Indonesia. So I want to explain a bit on this issue and how we are dealing with it at this moment. Shared heritage. First of all, what is a shared heritage? Well, this, for example, is shared heritage. I don't know if you recognize this picture. Does anyone know where this is?
Bali.
Sorry? Bali?
Bali.
Gal, yes. Oh. Yes, correct. Yeah. Okay. Have you been there? Okay. Exactly. This is the city of Gol. On the southern part of Sri Lanka. And so it was actually captured by the Portuguese in the 1670, conquered by the Dutch VOC in the 17th century. In the late 18th century, it was transferred to the British, and since 1948, it has become just a city in an independent state of Sri Lanka. So what we see here is all kinds of layers, several layers of culture. And the interesting thing here is it shows the concept of a shared heritage. Shared heritage is actually the point where cultures meet. And shared heritage, it shows that my own culture is not a coincidence, but that it is related in time and also in place to other cultures. And I think this is a very important thing to note in today's world that is so much globalizing. And so my culture is related to other cultures, it's also related to your culture. So that is what we try to capture in this concept of shared heritage. Quickly how we work now, and then how we are proceeding. We are now dealing actually with 10 countries, 3 Dutch parties, 2 principal, 3 programs, 2 methods, and many partners. Okay, I quickly skip to that. So these are the 10 countries, Indonesia being one, 3 Dutch parties involved, 4 affairs being the 10 embassies. So in Indonesia, there's the Dutch embassy and the Erasmus House. Then there is the Ministry of Culture, being actually the National Archives, here present by Jan, and the RCE, being the Cultural Heritage Agency of the Netherlands. And then there is the organization called Dutch Culture, located in Amsterdam. Dutch Culture is an organization, it's a kind of liaison organization. So Dutch Culture tries to link cultural institutes in the Netherlands with all other cultural institutes around the world. So what do we aim? We aim after a sustainable conservation of shared heritage in an ever-changing society. That is the main goal. And who do we reach at? We mainly want to reach out to heritage experts in the foreign countries. Since these happen to be the people that we can serve best, since we also are these experts, so that is where we best match. That is the idea. Now, what do we do? We have 3 teams that we work on. One is related to maritime archaeology, so mainly dealing with shipwrecks. One is dealing with historical inner cities. And one is dealing with museum collections. How do we do this? We have 2 ways. We do it by training, or we do it by advice. Training we can do, for example, in maritime archaeology. There is the UNESCO Field School for Underwater Cultural Heritage, located in Thailand, where we regularly offer courses. courses and trainings to dive in people. In the case of the historical inner cities, we have an institute in Rotterdam, the Institute for Housing and Urban Development Studies that we join with. They have quite a knowledge of all issues. Yes, that's Iboasti, correct. And there are some more people from Indonesia. Yeah. So, in these trainings, we invite a few people from all the countries to join and jointly discuss case studies and to learn from each other. The same is true for museum collections. Then there is also on specific issues we can help on request by, of course, as a foreign government. We can, of course, not just control the country and tell them what to do. We can only do so if we are requested and asked them to help. For example, this is an advice on the shipwreck, research on the shipwreck, the Avondsteer, which was found on the coast of Sri Lanka. This is the inner city of Pretoria. I've been here myself several times, where they are now working on a kind of regeneration of the city center, which at the moment is rather dilapidated and kind of no-go area. So jointly with the Tswana Municipal Authority, we are currently looking after, now what could you do to improve the situation? Museum collections, these are three of my colleagues that work on Ambarawa Museum. So here, jointly with Kereta Api, we had some workshops trying to define how the Ambarawa Museum could best be refurbished. And we do so with many partners on several issues. So that is so far actually the program as we do it so far. And but maybe we are now actually in a phase that we are trying to redefine the program for the next 4 years. And that actually National Archives is working on, and we are working on ourselves now too, and the embassy as well. So now we try to define how can we cooperate in the near future. I can quickly tell what we think to do, and maybe you can react on that. So what we think to do, well, Indonesia first of all we have to decide what countries do we want to work with, and Indonesia for us is, well, clearly that we would like to share, like to continue the cooperation with Indonesia, and also on the same three items. That is to say, the first item, or on historical inner cities, also will include issues on water-related issues, water management, since that is something that in Holland we also are dealing with at the moment, and we are very keen to learn how other countries do so. What we are mainly looking after now is what is different from the past. We are mainly looking after stable stakeholder per team, per country. For example, in Indonesia, if it comes to this inner city development and water-related issues, these days, I have been discussing with Ministry of Culture and Education, with Minister of Tourism, with ATR, being Spatial Planning and Land Use, being the Ministry of Transport, and being Public Works. So what we try to do, we would like to come with a kind of 4-year programs program with these people, with these institutions, but since there are so many, we hope that one will take the lead, and maybe ATR could be the one. And then what we try to do with them is to build a four-year program of training and advice, and that we jointly decide what would be the issues, what would be the case studies, what would be the approach. That is one. Another thing that we should look out for is that our government also wants to gain from this cooperation. That's usually the case with governments, they want to gain from the policies they do. But we have to understand. And I think it's also a good thing that we try to build an equal relation. We also, there are also things we want to learn, and we need from other countries. And so for that, so we try, we have to make sure that the things we have to get more clear, what our own issues are that we can gain on in other countries. So the first thing is we have to look after stable foreign partners. The second one is we have to look after what are our own needs. And the third one is that we these are, I think, at this moment, the most important things. Okay. So these, so this is how we are developing this moment, this policy. Johan, could you maybe also tell a little bit about how you, as National Archives, are now looking to the future and future cooperation with Indonesia?
Good evening. I'm Johan, I work for the National Archives. In Indonesia, Andri is our name. But there's not a very big difference between the policy from the last few years that we're planning to do for the next few years. But what we would like to do is collaborate more with our Dutch partners and combine ideas and policies that are important in fields like architecture and inner city redevelopment, that sort of things. So what we would like to do is digitize collections like a BOD, the old PEN, to make research easier for people in the field of restoration, and people who are interested in architecture. We are also digitizing in the Netherlands collections that are relevant for people here in Indonesia, for historians, people with special interest in built heritage. We have digitized all our maps from the 17th and 18th century and put them online. You can access them freely. And for instance, the jaarverslagen, BNW, so the annual reports of Peden from the period 1890 to 1930, I believe, will be put online as well. So that kind of things we would like to do more in the next few years, so that several fields will benefit from. So if you know a collection in Indonesia here, or somewhere else that are relevant for your research, and it fits within the program, please let me know. I forgot to bring my cards. So I arrived here, oh no, I forgot my business cards. But please give me yours and give me my email address. So we can keep in contact.